Good evening, everybody. This is Dr. Apoorv Mehra, and I represent Conceptual Orthopedics in the session today. With the due permission of Professor Sudhir Kumar, sir, I will like to start the session today. And the session will be in three parts. But before I speak further, I'll request Professor Sudhir Kumar, sir, to welcome the students and give me the permission to start. Sir.
Oh, sure. It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to welcome the students who are in fact appearing for the DNB clinical so-called practical examination. And as usual, it is going to be a very, very structured examination, as you must be aware about. And Dr. Apoorv and Dr. Shailesh Pai will give you the key points to go into it. With these words, I would ask Dr. Apoorv to start his presentation.
Thank you very much, sir. The chairperson for the evening is Professor Sudhir Kumar, sir. Co-chairperson is Dr. Shailesh Pai, and I am just going to talk to my friends and students. First of all the best to all of you. I have made a small PowerPoint. Let me take you through the journey and how the exam was conducted last time and what are we expecting, what type of questions are we expecting. I would like to thank Dr. Shailesh Pai for helping me with the presentation, and I will also like to thank Dr. Naufal for giving me an overview of what happened. So, Dr. Shailesh, can you see my screen clearly?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, that's how they plan to do it. It'll be single day, 31st August, Tuesday. The centers will increase. Classical 25 OSCE stations. 6 marks each, total of 150 marks. 4 Viva stations, 10 marks each. Ward round where you'll be taken in the wards, 4 different examiners, and 2 clinical cases. The sum total, you need to score 150. If I have to pick my point here, I'll be focusing on this area. This is 150, quite predictable. The second best area which I will like is the clinical case examinations, because this is something which is very basic. And this is a total of 220 marks. The other stations, multiple examiners. If I stay to the basics, I'll pass. But my peak score will be dependent upon 2 highlighted areas. Candidates will sit with the social distancing. Independent answer sheet for every question. Signed by the examiners. Relayed from the center NBE, and you have to mention your roll numbers, what station you're answering, and finally sign. There'll be 4 minutes of rest after each station, after 7 stations. The time allotted for each component, the each OSCE station will be displayed. The questions can be divided into 1 or 2 parts or 3 parts. I'll show you the examples. There will no more be MCQ typed. You will have to answer, describe, explain causes or solution. Once shown, the slide will not be displayed again. Candidate will keep the answer sheet separately. And obviously, the classical OSCE as conducted in different parts of the world. The examiners were stationed and the students were supposed to meet, but in this particular time of the year, it is going to be stationed students. So there will not be any movement. One answer sheet per OSCE, do not write on the back. Use simple black or blue color pen with ink. Do not try any colorful things. Assessment will be done at NBE Center in Delhi. The filled answer sheets are to be checked for signature of invigilators, roll numbers, and station number. They will be scanned and sent to the Delhi Center. I'm showing you some examples. There were some videos being shown and they had asked some questions. Now, example one, what are the two prominent components of this gate? And question number two, list three likely causes of the hip resulting in this gate. So for the time period allotted, the video might play like a GIF or a continuous video. And that's how it can continue. And just an example, one of the senior teachers of the conceptual family said, that's how you must answer it. Very simple. Your observation one and two and the causes. That's what the teachers and NB expects. Another example, a girl with a deformity, what's the diagnosis? They find two clinical findings. Name the structure which contributes to the deformity. Please understand, I'm not discussing the questions here. The session is only to orient you how the exams are conducted. All the things I'm showing will be discussed over the month. Example three, an image. So the images and videos are something that you will look for. Write the clinical features. So you can see a bony growth where the cortex is continuous with the cortex, the marrow going away from the joint, a gap between the growth and the bone. And we all know that one of the classical findings is large to feel, small to see, because it's something which is a bony stop with a cartilage gap. You can feel the cartilage gap on palpation, but you can't see it on the x-rays. What are the causes of the pain? Classical causes of pain in osteochondroma. And what is the indication of MRI? Here you will have to brainstorm, what's the malignancy in osteochondroma? For example, is chondrosarcoma. And I will award you with a special prize if anybody can mention in the chat box during the talk, what is the latest criteria of the cartilage thickness to label it malignant on an MRI? It has changed in the recent years. Hint, it's not classically 2 centimeters anymore. So these are the things they will ask you. Sometimes the questions will be divided into multiple slides. A 14-year-old boy is able to walk independently, presence with his attitude. What all do you see? 4 tests. What surgery performed? 3 parts, 3 slides. But all of them had images. How they did it in March. They focused on clinical cases and examination Obviously, there will be a practical exam. There were four questions which had two parts or more. 11 questions had x-rays. 4 had MRI images. 1 had arthrogram. That was question number 1. That's to disturb you. It's a rule of any exam which is virtual. They will try to shake you in the beginning. So do not worry. You have enough time. Focus. Total videos were around 7. And majority were images along with that. What you need to see here is clinical scenarios were 12 and tests were 7. 19 out of 25. That's about 78%. Region-wise, overall clinical scenarios, we mix it up 50%. Foot and ankle, which people don't read too. That's why we are starting tomorrow with this area. 2 in spine, 1 hip, 1 wrist and hand, 4 infection tumors, and 2 pediatric scenarios. That's how the 25 were divided. And that's how different things were there, clinical test, trauma, arthroplasty, surgical techniques, and investigations. Clinical examination, you have to understand, can be asked to you in 3 junctions, OSCE, ward rounds, and the clinical scenarios, 2 of them. So you should be knowing basics of clinical test, how to demonstrate, what to do, and more importantly, what not to do. What are the reasons of doing a test? Or they might show a video, is it correct or not? They can mark what is it showing you, any variant of the test, and the significance when you need that. This is what we already have in conceptual orthopedics. We've been developing it for last 1 year almost now. We are updating it. But the rule is the basics always stay the same. So we have a new pattern session like today's. We organize in March. Trauma session by Dr. Shailesh. COVID. Who is who by Dr. Shailesh and me. Shoulder. Different areas by the specialist teachers. Already archived for you to watch. We have covered the entire spectrum, what I just spoke to you. We haven't missed out anything. They will also cover your table vivas. They will also cover your ward rounds. We have 62 OSCEs ready for you, along with the mock test into it. This is the viva. 4 stations, 5-minute duration each. 10 marks per viva. Individual examiners will be there. And each candidate will go to each examiner. Divided into 4 areas. Instruments, implants, and surgical procedures. All this is beautifully covered in the app by Dr. Shailesh. Radiology is beautifully covered. We had last 2 days of MRI of spine, MRI shoulder, different X-ray images. Orthotics prosthesis, we have a phenomenal lecture by Professor Gopa Kumar and other areas too. Regarding the ward rounds, they will be taking you to the ward and just talking anything which is clinically relevant in majority. Can show you a splint, can ask you the mechanism of anything, can ask you the procedure that you will do, surgical steps, they can go anywhere. Again, individually marked. And then the final thing, which I believe, when you used to give a classical exam, it used to be 4 cases. 1 long, 3 short, or all 4 short, or universal. But here you have one case being relayed, and usually they can give you an infection of spine or a disc prolapse or any tubercular hip or any swelling. Depends on what best they can shoot. And some of the students told me that probably they had a spine case last time, which we are not exactly aware of. But spine usually is a tubercular spine or a disc prolapse, can be anything. We have case presentation of both in the app. And 15 minutes each case, and one case you can keep from your own center, or you can keep a dummy patient where you can ask any clinical test. And you know, in orthopedics, Tannenberg test, Thomas test are the usual ones that are always asked whenever examiner will come to you. And obviously the book that we have is going to help you in different areas that all of you already have in your hand. I can tell you one thing. 12 OSCE stations, 2 clinical scenarios, and 2 out of 4 ward rounds. At least, you will be able to handle with this book and the 2 videos of upper limb and lower limb clinical science by Professor Shantaram Shetty. If you do these 2, I believe a lot of things will be covered. How are we doing it this month? What have we thought? I will just share with you. And then before I pass on the baton to Dr. Shailesh, I will listen to whatever you people want from us. And then our senior faculties will take a decision. What can be done about it? We have decided that probably we'll give you 2 sessions of foot and ankle, 1 cold and 1 trauma. We'll give you trauma sessions by Dr. Shailesh every Wednesday. I will be the person to be with you throughout the month, every Thursday, same time. I'm going to listen to whatever you need and whatever we need to do. So be ready with whatever you want to talk on Thursday, 8 p.m., 5th August today, 12th August, 19th and 26th. On Fridays, we will have the next 2 Fridays. We will have pediatric ortho. And then subsequently, we will have sports medicine by Dr. Raju. So we will try to, in total, cover the entire spectrum. Whatever questions were asked recently, a similar pattern topics will be explained to you so that you have an orientation how to answer. And mind you, you will have the OSCE specialist from UK, Dr. Dimri, talking to you on Mondays. On Tuesdays, Professor Shetty would be talking to you, Professor Shantaram Shetty, sir. On Saturday, 21st August, we will have Professor Sudhir Kumar, sir, at 5 p.m. It's just 10 days before your exam. Sir is one of the most senior faculties of the country who has almost seen the evolution of how the exams have gone through. I think you can have a fair idea listening to his talk, what and how you must answer. 15th August is a bonanza for you, which we are planning. There'll be two mock tests towards the end, 27th and 29th August. We will close on 29th August. 30th August is your rest day. 31st is your day to perform. This is what we have planned for you. And let me have a look at what answers I have. So a lot of students have answered, and I'm happy that majority have answered correct. So we will have to pick up the first student who answered 1.5 centimeter. The organizers have to help me out with this criteria. Whosoever is the winner, let me know. I will talk to that person personally after this session is over. And if you are from Delhi, come and have lunch at the clinic. I'll be your host. If you are from Mangalore, you can go and meet Dr. Shailesh Bhai. So that's the award, apart from other things which can be given to you. And I'm happy that students could answer 1.5 centimeter. And now, if I have missed something, I will request Dr. Shailesh Bhai to guide the students. And then Professor Sudhir Kumar sir, at the end, will give you the final words. Dr. Shailesh sir and Dr. Nawful, thank you very much from the core of my heart to help me prepare with this presentation. It was not possible without the efforts. And thank you, sir. It is always a pleasure to speak in front of you. My voice still trembles. The panic is still there. It hasn't changed from 2005. Right? Thank you very much. Over to Dr. Shailesh, sir.
Thanks. Thanks, Dr. Apoor. I'm sure after the presentation, I don't think there is anything which is any doubtful to most of the students. It was very crystal clear. What all things will be there in the exam is well covered. I would just like to, from my point of view, give some, maybe some instructions or rather options what could be done. One is with feedback from the students that we had taken from last year and our own students who gave the exams, most of them told the time that they allotted is more than enough. Okay, even though you might feel that 4 minutes is too less for each station, trust me, the way the questions have been asked, it's very point specific wise. So like what was shown in Dr. Apoor's slides, name to give two examples or four conditions that way. And how the way you need to answer is be very specific. Think what key points are they expecting from you. There is no way in this world that you are going to write paragraphs of answers and not write that particular key point and expect them to give the marks. Okay. So what the examiner is actually expecting is those specific points, those specific words, which if it's not there, you might not get the adequate marks, which is allotted for that question. Okay. So the moment a station is put up on the PowerPoint slide in front of you, plan your answer. Don't directly jump in thinking how you to write the first question. Read all the questions. There will be 3, 4, or even sometimes 5 sub questions to a particular topic. Okay. Sometime you might find that one of the sub questions is actually giving you a clue to what the station is all about. Okay. So if you've already committed yourself and written the answers and then you have missed that particular clue, then there is no way you're going to go back and write, because number one, you need to write all the answers of that particular station in only one side of the page. They will not give you an extra page. Remember that. So there is no way you can cut it off and try ask for an extra page or something. Okay. So that is not allowed. So they give you 25 papers at the beginning and each paper is meant for one station. Okay. It's not one slide, but one station. So you need to plan what you're going to write. Plus, if there are many sub questions, you need to even plan the spacings, how you're going to write, because everything has to be finished in that one front side of the page. Whatever you write on the back side will not be scanned and sent, because you're writing in a particular center, but the correction is going on in Delhi. and center itself is just scanning the front part and sending. So whatever you write at the back is of no use. Okay, so you have to plan your answer in that particular way. And exactly for that same reason, don't try to write huge diagrams and occupy a lot of space, because then your keywords might be missed out. Okay, that is one. And then, like Dr. Apur told, first few questions or whatever, you might feel they're tough. Okay, but that should not hamper the way you attempt other questions. If you have got a station wrong, and trust me, there is no student who will get all 25 stations feeling they're very easy. So the way the exam will be conducted, you can expect that about 15 to 16 stations will be easy, 5 to 6 may be moderate, and 4 or 5 may be tough for any student for that matter. So unfortunately, if you get continuous 2 or 3 stations which are tough, now don't let that come in the way of you answering the next stations. So once you're past the station, don't think back on that. There is nothing you can do, because the moment you finish a station and next station slide is put up, your answer sheet is taken off. You can't go back and write. Okay, so that is one more thing that you should not do, that leave a space thinking that you will come and answer later on, because there is no way you can go back. The answer sheet, that particular answer sheet of that station, is taken away from you immediately once the next slide is put up. Okay, so don't do that. And if you find it tough, it's all right. It's tough for most of them. Maybe if your preparation is good enough, definitely it is tough for all of them. So that should not bother your overall performance. Okay. And then one more thing is, in last session, it was clearly told that there is no negative markings. This time, apparently, they have decided that there may be negative markings. Now, from the board, whatever information has come, they have not clearly mentioned which questions will have negative markings. Okay. So what the board has told was, last time in the students' answers, there were some huge blunders that they had performed, and the examiners who corrected felt that this particular candidate should not be given marks, or rather should be given negative marks. Now, I don't think that will be done, but having said that, if you do not know anything, also you attempt the question. It's okay, because it's very unlikely that it's an easy question and you do not know about it and you have created a blunder. So even though the board has told that there might be negative marks, do not think that there will be. Attempt all the questions, all the sub questions. Luckily, you might get it right just by attempting it, some marks. Okay. And with respect to ward rounds, one suggestion is, there's only 5 minutes per examiner. And the way it is done is, there are 4 examiners in different parts of the center, parts of the hospital, and one candidate goes to each of the examiners, and the examiner gets only 5 minutes. So it is very, very tough for the examiner to really assess you for 5 minutes. So word of caution, whatever has been asked, listen to it carefully and answer as simple as possible. Once again, do not utter blunders. Mistakes might be pardoned, but blunders won't be. So if you do not know, you can just request the examiner that you don't know, and maybe he might ask something else. But if you really tell something which is totally off track, the examiner might just conclude that you have absolutely no clue and you're not worked during your residency. That may be the thought that the examiner gets, and he might not give you good marks. Okay. So if you know, right, you tell it. But if you don't know, don't do any guessworks there. Not in the ward rounds. Okay. Same thing applies even with the table viva. Table vivas are very simple. Radiology, all standard radiographs will be kept. I don't think any examiner will try to test all difficult, because they only have 5 minutes. It's very, very difficult to really assess. So they will give straightforward, simple, to the point x-rays, which are very good. And I think you should be able to get all of them right. Okay. And clinical examination, unlike the previous years where we had 4 cases and the biggest problem any candidate faced was speaking to the patient and getting the history, because many a time we had to go to a different state to take the exam and that particular language was not there. So all those are taken care of in this particular system. So it's much easier to pass this particular system of exam. Trust me, unofficially, last time it was, I think, 85% of the people who gave the exams passed. Unofficial numbers, of course, but most of them and most of our students whom we spoke to, all of them had cleared their exam. So it is very easy. So just keep your calm. Do a good preparation. You have enough time now, and whatever coming up sessions that Dr. Apur has mentioned, these are going to be bonus for you. Most of this is already covered and there in the app, so you should finish them. And as a revision, these will be bonus sessions. Do not come to these sessions, coming up sessions, with the blank mind. Okay, so that it will not be it will not be any helpful for you. So if you take my word, you should have already covered them. So if, for example, if you have a clinical examination session coming up tomorrow, previously or that day morning, you can already finish the video which is already there in the app and then come to the session and see if you can get anything extra. Don't come with a blank mind. So I think from my side, I think that should be it. And thanks, Dr. Appu, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Shailesh. And I think what I understand is if that's the percentage of people passing, you have to work hard to get into 15%. And the rule is the same. I always used to do this when I was a resident. I used to think, if I have a hip case, and if I am the examiner, what will I ask? So it is very obvious. I will ask the Thomas test, the Trendenberg test, opposite hip, ipsilateral knee, the deformities, how to test it. Those are the things I used to think. And that's what always happens. But now let's listen from the man who will tell you what basics are. And in fact, he has examined all of us almost. Professor Sudhir Kumar, sir, your words, and then we conclude, sir. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Apoor and Dr. Shailesh have, in nutshell, told you the methodology of examination. This is what you are going to face. And it is obvious that this methodology, which has been adopted in the COVID, is a very objective examination. That means the subjective bias on the part of the examiner is very little. And the time given to the examiner is also very limited. Hence, the conceptual orthopedics, this app which has given you a training throughout, is going to be a great help to you. So objectivity in this examination will mainly pull you through. So far as the clinical part and the table vibers are concerned, the scenarios given to you, most of the time, there'll be hardly any patient these days which will be kept. But however, you can still find one case where we can ask you for a demonstration of a clinical sign. And because of COVID, possibly you have not been able to lay your hands on the patients. But you have definitely seen the conceptual connect, which is a great help, which you can go through. And if you look at the clinical examination book, it is almost a very comprehensive representation of what you are going to see in your day-to-day clinical practice. So the examinations, which is going to help you, one is your conceptual connect, the revision of the OSCEs, and mind it, the ward round, which Shailesh has pointed out, is also very important, because whatever you speak over there to your examiner, the examiner will at once guess. He will come to know whether you have really worked in your ward diligently or not. Because the questions which are put up are very simple and straightforward by the bedside of the patient. There is a fixator applied. There is a traction going on. There is a, suction apparatus. There are crutches lying there. Walking frames lying there. So there are dressing materials there, the plaster materials there. So it is all your day-to-day practice. So what is needed ultimately is your humble approach which you should be showing, which you should, we should come out automatically from you when you are answering your examiner. Listen to his question first, because most of the time what happens is some of the students only listen to half the question and start blurting out. That gives a bad impression. So you should listen to, because there is enough time to listen. You know, 5 minutes is a big time. You have enough time to listen to your examiner and take a pause and then answer. That is very important. As it is important in OSCE that you are doing an objective testing, you are being tested objectively there, that you read all the questions first. You spend, that means out of 4 minutes, you should be spending at least 20 to 30 seconds reading your questions so that that gets into you and you are able to manage your question in a sequential manner. The answers can be done in a very sequential manner. So my suggestion to all my students have been that you be a good listener. When your examiner asks you a question, and give a pause and then answer. That is the best way of doing it. Then you are, it gives you a cool, it gives you a cool that you are, you see, what is most important in your examination is not to get overreacted. So what we call as maintain your equanimity. So this is very important. Maintaining an equanimity in your own behavior, your expression will come out automatically in this, in that format. With these words, I'll just close and wish you all the best. And I'm sure this month is going to be a great feast for you. And you must be ready with the with your knowledge for answering and taking interactive part in whatever sessions are being conducted. Thank you so much, and my best wishes to all my students. Thank you.
Sir, the winner is Dr. Nusrat Khannam.
Oh.
Answered 1.5 centimeter.
Nusrat, that's the only, I mean, the answer which has been given. The first person to give the answer.
Lot very of good answer, but 1.5 centimeters.
My congratulations. You have a well-read students. I think we should feel proud of it, and we should encourage them to learn the right concepts in this discipline. My best wishes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Shailesh, sir. Thank you, Dr. Nofal. Thank you, everybody. And remember one thing, whenever you appear for any exam, rule number one, examiner is always correct. Rule number two, in case of any confusion, refer to rule number one. And the classical line is, if you feel you will clear it, you will. If you feel you can't, you won't. In either case, you will be correct. So start speaking this for next 3 weeks, 4 weeks, I am doing it. And we will be waiting for the party. Bye, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. Bye. All the best wishes.